Hello everybody, welcome back! We are on round 17 and this time we're featuring Jordan Palmer. We're currently looking into the name of his opponent, and by the way, I'm Marco Spataro and I'm joined here by Philip Scholz.
Hey everyone, what's up? And yeah, we've seen Jordan yesterday already, how he slapped his way into day 2 and he kept on slapping, being currently 3-0. And yeah, he's doing quite good in day 2, so... and in a pretty good position. I mean, he still has to win a lot to make it into top 8, but he's already in a good position for a strong finish here. And yeah, I said yesterday I like his ADP build. I think it's it looks pretty good. And yeah, he's certainly trying to prove it as well.
Indeed, and as we are already on round 4 of day 2, things are starting to take shape and we can already see which players are looking good to get into top. There's already, as we just featured, someone that was 15-1, Shibata. So yeah, there's also Taketo that is doing pretty well, 15-1 as well. So yeah, we see already a lot of people that are going straight for the throat, trying to take down this tournament. And as well, as you just said, Jordan is looking in a pretty good position to do so. But we jump right into the game. Jirachi start for buff player, and we see the opponent is probably playing, yeah, ADP Spiritomb.
Yep, and it will be the classic from our last qualifiers, ADP Spiritomb versus ADP Zacian. Both decks used to be extremely dominant in the past. Now they have both fallen off a little bit. We've not seen that much success from them lately, but yeah, these players now adapted a little bit and brought it back and are both sitting at the 12-4 record, so both are doing really good, and it seems like those decks are climbing back into the top of the tier list.
Fantastic stuff for the lads here. And there we go, Energy Spinner going second, allowing you to fetch free energies if you like. And we're just looking at a quick look through his deck. We see those ADPs, those Zacian. And interestingly, I think a very interesting card he plays is the Cherish Pulse, something I did not expect to see coming back into the meta. But he really wants to find the cards he need, and I can understand that choice. So yeah, we go here. It actually just takes one energy off of that Energy Spinner, and Stellar Wish is probably fetching a Marnie, I would say, if he wants to draw some extra cards. The only problem is that the opponent has only one card left in their hand.
Yeah, so that's so, the disadvantage of Marnie, but I guess for this, for now, Jordan doesn't really need to necessarily play it. He can just wait a turn. This Great Catcher is actually pretty good. He might want to play it just to make sure that his opponent doesn't get a Stellar Wish, but nope. Values keeping it instead. And goes for the
prepares to set up. Draws at Zacian. Fantastic as well. The Zacian here means they will be able to Intrepid Sword, thicken up his hand a little bit. And yeah, as well, the Spiritomb player had a pretty decent start, started with Jirachi, fetched some the Jinx, the ADP, and as well attached an energy to the ADP, which is probably the most important thing that you need to do with that deck. So there we go, Intrepid Sword. Not trying finding any energies, and no supporters as well. Free scoop up nets, though. I'm not sure if that falls under the category of good. So we're just waiting here for the opponent to take a choice. This is a very interesting matchup because in the moment you have ADP Spiritomb that attacks with mainly one prizers, you do have the ADP Zacian, which if it's able to connect the attacks correctly onto the Spiritombs and knocking them out before they pile up enough damage, they can never be one-shot, right? And in this way, I think this is the way that Jordan needs to go. Just trying to snipe those Spiritombs as soon as they hit the board once the Altered Creation GX is in effect. Because otherwise, he can just be knocked out any of his Pokemon so suddenly.
Yeah, the ADP Spiritomb, I guess, originally I thought that it would be relatively close to Mirror. But I think after considering it more carefully, that the ADP Spiritomb should have a slight advantage here. Just because
yeah,
it doesn't have two prizes. So usually when one of the ADP players puts down the Denne, the other one can just knock it out with Ultimate Ray and then knock out a Zacian. But Patrick with his ADP Spiritomb is in the comfortable position of being able to put down a Denne, because afterwards, as long as he doesn't put down another two prizer, then it's Jordan still can't finish the game by knocking out two prizes. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that the Shrine of Punishment damage from Patrick is adding up quite quickly, while he can use his Jinx to heal the ADP, and so he can prepare one shot while also keeping his ADP healthy. So I would say I would say advantage probably goes to Patrick here, and of course he also went first and got the ultimate creation first. So it will be interesting to see if Jordan is able to combat that and deal with it, because it's certainly a rough position.
Indeed, indeed. There we go. Celebration as well here for Jordan. Excellent start, as you just explained, for the ADP Spirit Bomb, and looking already pretty scary. That Shrine of Punishment, as you said, hinders mostly Jordan. But the Marnies, I think, are the key here to win against Spirit Bomb, which is a deck that sometimes misses the energies and does not utilize at its best potential the ADP, because sometimes the ADP, is, especially in this matchup, the ADP just stays in front to do the Altered Creation. As soon as the Altered Creation is in effect, the Ultimate Ray is not the best attack, especially against these chunky Pokemons that Jordan is dishing out. And as well, the ADP will probably be retreated, because giving away all these prizes in just one hit to the ADP second player is not good at all. But I have a wisdom as well. See if he decides to save up a card and go for the day. I think he is. Find another switch.
No, that's not optimal. Discarding so many switches is always painful for a deck. Like Zacian, but it always needs to reset the attacker. But yeah, at the very least he does have his ADP, so for a straight Zacian deck this would be pretty devastating. For Zacian ADP it's still acceptable. And yeah, the Danny here now, definitely painful as well, just gives Patrick the opening to take a knockout on the Danny with Ultimate Ray, and then he has those two Spirit Bombs being already powered up slowly. Getting
exactly,
ready
it would be interesting to see. I mean, I would like to see this ADP surviving, just for the fact that if the ADP gets knocked out by the Spirit Bomb player, he just needs to take a knockout on the Jirachi. Thanks to boss orders, that's gonna happen, like, sooner or later. Once again, this is a very fast matchup, I would say. Not rather in the setup, but rather as soon as the Altered Creation is in play, it's just one or two plays that determine the destiny of the game.
Yes, exactly.
So Acrobike, I really, by the way, I really like the inclusion of Acrobikes in any ADP deck, because you need to fetch the cards that you want. ADP is a deck that is very reliant on the first turns of setup, and so as long as you're able to draw the cards you need, you will not have any problems. Big Charm as well on the ADP. Excellent play, I would say.
An Aurora Energy, discarding an Aurora Energy. Always somewhat
that's a bit concerning. That's
yes,
a bit concerning.
For sure.
And Ultimate Ray, just sitting this ADP, not fantastic,
yes.
But at least it utilizes the ADP, right?
Yeah, at least he gets going a little bit, and now accelerating his energy, spreading them a little bit there, somewhat surprising. I would have guessed just to powering up the Jirachi to use Slab.
Yeah, he probably doesn't play any Darkness basic energies,
yes.
And Spirit Bomb attacks only with Darkness, so it's pretty... I found myself when I was playing this deck that sometimes you needed the Darkness energy, but sometimes in the early game you just wanted to draw rather the water or the metal energies, because you need that Altered Creation in the first turns. As well, let's notice that he did not play any supporters.
Yeah, exactly. So a gust effect to knock out Vatidana would have been amazing, of course, but no supporter, no gust. Just an Ultimate Ray into the ADP, now giving Jordan at least some room to come back from this. Of course, his ADP is already heavily damaged, so... Oh, but...
Yeah. That's fine, the Malolana.
But
pretty sweet.
Yeah, the Malolana doesn't do that much for... Only, the ADP will be at 100 after this turn anyways.
Yep.
So another Ultimate Ray.
I would probably charge up the Zacian at this point and attack with it. What do you say?
Yeah, that's probably better. Just to get the Zacian going and not have the ADP in the active position. Because this ultimate this ADP doesn't do anything meaningful on the Zacian. The damage doesn't matter, you always expect them to get one shot anyways. Yeah.
It's just a liability at this point, the ADP. And this is how it feels. For example, against Malamar, ADP is great, it's a big tank, But Malamar is not part of the meta anymore, thanks God. So at this point, ADP in most matchups just becomes liability. Against Pikaram, it's just an easy way for them to draw four prizes in one hit because they can tag bolt and draw all the prizes. But instead, in some matchups, it was good. But right now, ADP just feels like, as I said, a liability. And maybe the Zacian combo that we just saw in the previous match might be the way to go now. But yeah, Zacian V hitting hard with the Brave Blade, but not enough.
Yep, that big charm,
That big charm
really
doing
big.
work.
Yes, and yeah, that's just the strength of this ADP Spiritomb deck. Having the tools to do very power to add up your opponent's damage, but also like healing your Pokemon, keeping them healthy, and always moving the damage back and also increasing the
Exactly.
HP. Really strong
Yeah.
combination.
Pretty scary stuff here. That Spiritomb is gonna hit for a lot. Yeah, I think it one shots. Yeah, for sure one shots the Zacian. So thanks to the Hustle Belt. So it's pretty scary, I would say, right now for Jordan. He needs to take more than one Nocaute in one turn, and that's gonna be basically impossible because of that Shrine of Punishment and that Jinx combo. Able every turn to both pressure him and as well to control the damage that the opponents can dish out.
Yeah, exactly. Also, Jordan's hand is of course terrible right now. It's basically the only hope he has is to get a reset stat. Get a re I don't think he plays reset stat. So get a Marnie and hope that Patrick doesn't draw any energies anymore. Because yeah, I guess Patrick needs a tool as well. So he needs an energy and a tool to get a knockout with Spiritomb.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
So,
because
I don't
it's.
know. I think the best bet that Jordan has in this case is to hope that the Spiritomb deck does not find the last energies, which is definitely possible.
Yeah, the amount of energies are definitely limited, and three already were used on the ADP, then another one was discarded for Aurora
Exactly.
energy.
And that's the fifth one there with the Spiritomb. So, it's gonna be. I think it will call it's much closer than it looks like. Right now it looks like pretty bad for Jordan. But just because of the fact that the Spiritomb deck sometimes falls short in the late game when it does have the damage but does not have the way to do it, I think it's the best gateway here for Jordan to win. Let's see, this end is not fantastic.
Not at all.
Setting up another Zacian. I don't know.
Definitely needs some way of disruption. So,
Yeah.
yeah,
It's pretty scary here, I would say, for
oh,
the Zacian player. Like,
actually,
I mean, I
there's
guess
no
any ADP.
disruption in his deck.
Yeah.
So at least, I mean, he can at least use the Zigzagoon to knock out the Spiritomb maybe, and then use
Yeah.
Ultimate Ray for something stronger.
If he draws a boss order, he is in an excellent shape here. He takes out the knock onto the Spiritomb. Whatever the opponent puts in the active spot, he can just catch up the other Spiritomb. And then I don't think he can get one shot if he puts the ADP out. I'm calculating the damage. He can get one shot actually.
Yeah, with
Just free damage.
Spiritomb with Rainbow and Hustle Belt, it can reach incredible numbers very, very quickly.
So here we see the Slowbridge. Grabbing, not finding a boss order, so I think it's the main thing to catch here.
Yes, for sure. And interestingly, but Jordan didn't use his Primate Wisdom to put the Scoop-Up Net on top of his deck before using the Denna, because right now Scoop-Up Nets would be very handy to maybe get
Very
some.
great catcher. Not bad, but not what he wants to see, I would say.
Yeah, for sure. Doesn't really do much.
Yeah, and five unplayable cards. Pretty sad. Doesn't have Primate Wisdom. Maybe there is the magic in that card, but I'm not sure. Let's see what he draws. So I sip it on the Malala. That's gonna be very handy right now. And no, just draws a Metal Saucer. No metal targets in the bench. Oof. Yeah, now he has a choice. Do I just leave the Jirachi and.
Yeah,
Oh, I mean, I hope it.
if he at least had a switch, he could just Energy Switch and Metal Saucer to the Jirachi. Switch it active and
Yeah.
take a knockout on the Jinx to go down to 3 prizes, and then he could finish off the game on the ADP in the next turn, but he can't even attack right now, so...
I would say just leave the Jirachi there and hope the opponent does not have a boss orders, because right now the Jinx is gonna move 1 damage away off of that ADP. But if it's not able to heal it in any way, then it can win. But there's the energy. Is there also a boss orders in that hand? There's a switch as well. Hold on. Yeah, directly into the spirit tomb. Oh, instead he just goes for a building spite. Interesting.
And there's a boss order. And that's the game. And
that's
Patrick,
gonna be a game. He has everything.
Yeah, Patrick getting a really strong start. And then getting a really strong start and not losing footing at all, just continuing to put on pressure, and Jordan just wasn't able to deal with it. And as I mentioned earlier, I said, I do believe that Patrick had a slight edge matchup-wise here. And Jordan, of course, didn't draw too amazing, right? He didn't get great cards, but that's just sometimes how it goes. And
exactly so. Yeah, we saw, as we said, very interesting matchup, Spirit Humanization, 2 different phases of ADP. But that was our round 17. So Jordan unfortunately was not able to get a foothold into this game.
I think an interesting change to the matchup is the Zigzagoon and Scoop Up Nets. They can, I think they might shift the advantage back into the ADP player's advantage a bit more, the Zacian ADP player's advantage a bit more again, because those Spiritombs can get knocked out so easily with a couple of Zigzagoon ability activations. And then, we saw if Jordan had gotten a gust effect, like the boss's order, to take a knockout on the Spiritomb, Patrick would have been certainly in a much harder situation. So I guess the Zigzagoons. Kind of change the dynamic of matchup a bit, and it might actually be in Zacian's favor once again. But of course, we didn't get to see that. Jordan just didn't get, just didn't draw too well. So it ended up in a loss for him. And so props to Patrick, who's now 4-0 in day 2, I believe, and at a 13-4 record. So pretty strong showing so far. And if he can keep this going, then he will make top 8, probably at least. So we will keep an eye on that. We have a couple of other interesting players, for example, Taketo Seki, who made top 4 in our second qualifier, is at 15-1, I believe. So more than just 1 foot in the top 8 already.
And I think it's pretty much granted at this point, right?
He needs 1 more win. So.
Oh, yes, exactly.
And then it's dependent on tiebreakers, but... I think he's he's definitely in a good position no matter what happens. And
Azul doing pretty well, I would say.
Yep, but Taketo, thanks to his finish in our earlier qualifier, also is looking pretty good to get himself a spot in the Invitational, since he was like top 16-ish before this tournament, and now he's doing really well. Other players, of course, Dominik Malicki from Poland has made day 2 at all 4 qualifiers and basically guaranteed himself a spot in the Invitational now. Even though he was almost safe before this, he still made day 2 just to be extra safe. Kimpo Bega as well, having a very really solid record in day 2, and he won the last qualifier. So it seems like he's on a good way to get himself a spot in the Invitational by just playing the last 2 qualifiers, since he couldn't attend the first 2. So very impressive as well.
Yeah, unfortunately he couldn't, and I think he's still playing, but he had a horrible start, I think. He had Thunder Mountain and Coco in the prizes, he told me. So hopefully he's able to come out on top anyway.
I
and
mean,
he's on a 13 increased score right now.
I mean, these days Bolton as a second option makes double... pricing double prism stuff not that bad, right?
Yeah, exactly. Once you have Bolton, it's gonna be pretty much fine.
Yep. Anyways, that's it from this round. We will keep an eye on the interesting players that are making a claim to get a spot in the Limitless Invitational. We will try to get some of them on stream, and I hope you enjoyed this. For now, we will go to a break, and we will be back soon.